morning, good afternoon, everyone. This is Edgar Bahilo, working as lead data scientist for Siemens Energy in the industrial applications division. And today I have with me Mohamed Ahmed, also working as senior data scientist in the same team than me. And our idea today is to show you what we have learned from scaling time series forecasting in the cloud. But before that, I would like that we make a small pause and we close our eyes. If you open them again, most likely you will be looking to a computer screen, or you will be on site surrounded by colleagues looking to the bigger screen. And all of these electric devices or electronic devices, they are powered by energy. And at Siemens Energy, we are actually trying to provide you this energy in the safest, in the most safest, reliable, and environmentally friendly supply. So if we move on, let me just introduce you or set up in a very high level. Siemens Energy is divided into five main divisions. So we have the industrial applications divisions where Mohamed and I are working for. And there we are basically offering service to any kind of industrial equipment that you can imagine, medium gas turbines, reciprocate compressors, small gas turbines, etc. Then we have the generation colleagues that they are helping our customers towards the path of decarbonization with new solutions and more efficient machines. Then we have the new energy business colleagues that they are working with hydrogen and power to X technologies and low carbon fuels. The renewables, previously known as Siemens Gamesa, where we offer wind offshore and onshore power solutions. And finally, the transmission colleagues that they are manufacturing all of the equipment that connects these complex energy systems. So basically they are the spider under the web. And we have digital solutions or digital products and machine learning initiatives that they are either cross company or cross division. But today we are going to focus in what we are working in the industrial applications divisions, concretely in the business unit of distributed oil and gas. So we have four main focus areas for machine learning use cases: the time series forecasting one that we will talk in detail today, computer vision, NLP and semantics, and anomaly detection for enabling predictive maintenance. And today we are going to talk about dispatch optimizer. So if we move to the next slide, what is dispatch optimizer? And more important, why forecasting is important in dispatch optimizer? The thing is that our customers, they have different industrial equipment located in their power plants. And in order to operate this industrial equipment, they need to deal with the market rules where they are operating. So some of our customers, they sell electricity to the spot market. Some of the customers, they sell capacity to the national grid via power purchases agreement. But what all of these customers, they have in common is that they need to decide with some certainty. So basically, they need to decide how they are going to operate the power plants in advance, because they need to communicate this to the transport system operator or to the market operator. So questions as if the electricity price is going to go up or not, fuel price will go up or not, will I be able to deliver this capacity, how much demand I will have to fulfill, are questions that are very difficult to answer in a qualitative way, and we actually need to answer them in a quantitative way, and that's why we are using forecasting. So in dispatch optimizer, what we are trying to do is to use different forecasting techniques to forecast the demand, the capacity, the fuel, and the electricity prices of these power plants. And how we are doing it? So we are using what we call, or what we have investigated, what we call forecasting strategies. So most of you, maybe you are familiar with all of the traditional time series models like ARIMA, exponential smoothing, and so on. And most of the implementations of these models, they follow what we call a recursive or iterative strategy. So basically you fit a model that estimates some parameters that is able to predict T plus one. And then you use this T plus one to feed it into the model again to forecast T plus two. So the problem is that when you do this iteratively, the error that you are having in your forecast accumulates over time. And also one of the contraries is that these kind of forecasting techniques, usually they converge to the mean in larger forecasting horizons. And the main purpose of use machine learning is to have at least something better than the mean. So moving on, we have the next forecasting strategy, that is the direct forecasting strategy, the one that we choose it for our problem, where we don't have accumulation of the error because we have one model per forecasting horizon. We have more flexibility because we can put different features to the different models. But the problem is that we have many models, and also the models, they are not really communicating with each other. So for instance, the 40 hours ahead forecasting model is not learning anything from the 24 hours ahead forecasting model, and vice versa. So if we go to the next forecasting strategy, sorry, Mohamed, could you go back? We have the multiple input output forecasting strategy, where we are combining both of the the best of both worlds. And we have one model for all of horizons. But the problem is that most of the implementations of these multiple output forecasting models, they are done using any kind of recursive neural network, either a plain vanilla RNN or an LSTM neural network. And they are usually very expensive to train. Most of the times we need GPUs. So yeah, it's not that feasible always to go with this strategy. For our application, for this Apache optimizer, we decided to go with direct forecasting strategy because we wanted more flexibility. And if we move to the next slide, the more important question comes into place, that is how we are actually doing the forecasting. What features are we using? So in direct forecasting, what you need to ensure is that your observation window needs to match your forecasting horizon. So for instance, if you are going to forecast 24 hours ahead, you will have to set up your observation window 24 values in the past. So that means that if you use, for instance, lag values or the previous values of the time series for the forecasting horizon 48, you will start in lag 48 and beyond, and so on and so on. So of course, we are using much more things than lags. We are using moving averages, Fourier components to model the seasonality, calendar features, and some handcrafted features that unfortunately we cannot reveal today. But if you are into Python or R, these two packages, TSFresh for Python or Feast for R, they can give you a nice overview of what features you could potentially use for your forecasting problem. So now, before we move to the general architecture, maybe just a content disclaimer. This talk is not about how we are implementing the state-of-the-art forecasting models. So we are not going to talk about temporal fusion transformer, DPR, or global models that they can predict multiple time series. This talk is about the lessons learned from scaling thousands of models into production. Also, another disclaimer is that when we started the development of this project, we were really not aware about the results of the M5 for where deep learning, again, outperforming traditional time series methods. And most of our experimentation was using ARIMA models for baseline models, and then SGTBus and random forest for improvement. So now, taking a step a bit more into the details, this is a high-level architecture of the system that we build with Dispatch Advisor. We are using, say, six main ABS services, step functions for microservice orchestration, Lambda for configuring these step functions and for lightweight data processing, Amazon SageMaker as the runtime of our containers for both pre-processing and feature engineering and training, EventBridge to communicate with the different steps of the workflows, and SageMaker models for our model artifacts, and then Amazon Elastic Container Registry for the containers that we are using in the different steps. So how this usually looks is that we have some code that we have developed in SEER or end-to-end data science platform. We push this code to our CI/CD system, and then the CI/CD pipelines, they do the subsequential release for each of the components of this workflow. And in production, basically we have new data arrival every certain time. And when we have received this new data, we have something called Data Listener that compares that the raw data that we have received is fresher in comparison to what we have in the feature store. So basically, for each of the models that I have mentioned before, electricity, demand, fuel price, etc., and for each of our customers, for each of the countries that we are forecasting this electricity price, we decide if we have received new data or not. And if yes, we go to the pre-processing workflow. If not, we don't go. When we go to the pre-processing workflow, we create our features for inference, coming back to the slide that I mentioned about these rolling windows and observation windows. And if what we have received differs quite a lot from what we previously forecasted, then we trigger our model monitoring strategy. Sorry, we trigger our retraining strategy. If this is not the case, we just give that the model they were performing good predictions, and then we continue to inference that later on is stored in our data lake in Snowflake. So having said that, I hand over to Mohamed for the lesson learns. Thank you.
Thanks, Edgar. And hi, everyone. This is Mohamed going over through some of the lessons that we have learned. Yeah, so the first lesson that we have learned is that we need MLOps engineers and that we need enough of them. So, I mean, this might seem quite simple and intuitive lesson, but actually there is lots of controversy and discussion going throughout the data science community about, you know, whether, I mean, teams should have, like data scientists should do all the work, or, I mean, different roles should be distributed to different, job roles. So in our team, we had some software engineers and data scientists, and we thought that, you know, combining these, two roles, these two people, we will be able to simulate MLOps engineers' skills. But that was not the case, and we ended up, with lots of discussions and lots of meetings trying to understand each other. So, I mean, that's a tough lesson that we have learned, that we definitely need MLOps engineers. The second lesson that we have learned is metadata-driven machine learning. So, as Edgar said, a product like Dispatch Optimizer is offering lots of machine learning solutions, like machine learning forecasting solutions, so for different customers and different model families and then different horizons. When it comes to the customer, I mean, we have lots of customers who use our equipment, and these customers have different power plants, and within each power plant, they have different units. And actually, for some of the model families, we are doing the forecasting on a combination level. So basically, we do an aggregate level for a combination of machines. Imagine that a customer have five units within his power plant, but he only wants to do the optimization for three of them. So then we need to regard these three machine units as one entity, combination ID, and then we try to do the aggregate demand forecast for that machine. So imagine that having lots of customers, and each of these customers have lots of units, and according to the number of units that they have, we have an exponentially increasing amount of combination IDs. And then it comes to the second level of hierarchy, which is model family. So for each of these units or combination IDs, we're predicting different target variables. We're predicting electricity prices, fuel prices, electricity demand, and maximum capacity and efficiency of the machines. And then for each of these target variables, we're doing horizons, or direct forecasting strategy. So basically, for each horizon, we have a different set of hyperparameters, ranges for the hyperparameter tuning to start from, features and these kind of things. So having a scalable solution that could actually, I mean, each pipeline within this solution could work for all these combinations is something that has a very connection, very important connections with the metadata itself. So we need a pipeline. If I go here for an example, what you can see to the left here is a batch processing inference pipeline. And you want this pipeline to work in the same way. I mean, not in the same way, but I mean, in the same pipeline or the same steps for all the inputs that you get. I mean, no matter what the inputs are. And what you see in the middle here is that we're running a mapping function where we are applying this same batch processing job for multiple inputs, and the inputs here are differing a lot. So according to the metadata that each of these parallel processes is getting, we're triggering a different, a pipeline with completely different configurations. Imagine that if this was a pre-processing or training pipeline, then the set of features themselves might be dependent on some of the inputs here, the customer, the model family, and the horizon itself. So another lesson that we have learned is that model training is harder than what we thought. Model monitoring is harder than what we thought. So, I mean, a normal pipeline for machine learning workflows is that you do processing, you do training, you get a model artifact, you dump it into a storage, and then whenever you want to do, inference, online inference or offline inference, you just pull up that model artifact and then do the inference. For the model training, you either do passive model training. So basically, whenever you run an inference job, you compare the statistics with the inference features, with the baseline statistics for the model, and then you can tell whether the model is deviating over time or not. With active model monitoring, you actually get ground truth data from some entity, and then you use this ground truth data. You compare it with the results of your inference or the predictions that you had, and then according to some metrics, you can tell whether the model is deviating or not. That's supposed to be easy, but the problem is that, especially for us in our like time series forecasting models, you really need to wait. So let's say that we have made like an inference for the next horizon. So let's take an example here. Whenever we receive a pre-processed data, and we run training at that example, for example, and then we do an inference for the next horizon. If you want to do model monitoring for the data in that you made inference for, you need to wait until you get ground truth data for the next horizon. So if you received data for less than the period of the horizon, which basically something that we get a lot, you don't have to perform model monitoring. So you need to wait until you get the whole chunk, and then you could actually run your comparison. So putting this into the model monitoring and having it as an active model monitoring concept was something that we learned in a better way. Here I can show an example of the model monitoring results. So what you can see to the left here is that these are the model monitoring results, which is basically the error over time for different combination IDs and for different horizons. You can see the differences between them in the trend, or you can say in the average of the errors. What you can see to the right here is that this shows how the error changes over time, but it also you can notice a couple of things here. So the coloring here is according to the model artifact that was used to create the inference. So basically, the errors that you get here are the errors for the inference that was done using the model with this color. What you can notice here is that you can notice how retraining is automatically triggered whenever we reach the threshold for the error metric. You could also notice how model retraining is actually reducing the error. While we do model retraining, we actually drop down a lot in the error metrics. And what you notice is that whenever there is a spike, some chunk of data or within the horizon of data, we don't automatically trigger model monitoring. So wait until we get the whole chunk for the horizon, and we also take the average of the errors over time, like rolling averages, so that not to, to have like unstable workflow. Here are some examples. Here we have the error metrics for two algorithms, XGBoost and Random Forest. What you can see to the left here is that an aggregate errors for XGBoost are worse than for Random Forest. But when you look at specific cases, you will see that actually for lots of the retraining job that we have done, XGBoost was picked up for some of the specific periods of time. Another lesson that we have learned is versioning. And as data scientists, we usually know that versioning model binaries and data is a common practice. So you basically run different experiments, and you need to version your models artifacts in order to benchmark them against each other and tell if, for example, any deviation is happening and which one of them is the best. You usually also version your data in order to track the lineage of your data, to perform maybe simple evaluation and monitoring of the models. Performance. What we learned is that code versioning is a very important part, and actually code versioning it in the right way is a very important part as well. So basically, because we have separated workflows for training, inference, and processing and model monitoring, and for each of these workflows we have separate CI/CD pipelines, so basically separate repos with CI/CD pipelines. Whenever we try to do integration testing, we do it on the level of the workflow. Okay, so whenever you make a change in training, for example, you only run the integration testing for training. So how to solve the problem of checking the harmony of the whole workflow, including all the pipelines? What we did is that we adopted semantic versioning concept, in which that whenever we make a commit or a release, we tell whether there is a major change or a minor change in the code. So we have a small piece of workflow orchestration tool that's called workflow monitoring tool. And basically what it does is that it listens to the releases that we do. So whenever we make a release, if it's a major release, then this workflow monitoring tool runs a full pipeline, like a full integration testing for the unified solution. Here are some examples of these artifacts, like the registries. So on top here, you can see our model registry. So whenever we make a training job, we dump all this information regarding the model. In the middle, you can see our feature store. And on the bottom, you can see the code registry. The last lesson that I'm going to talk about is that we should become our own Oracle. And what I mean here is that you need to actually like monitor your workflows in a more integrated way. So if you look at the left here, you have a happily isolated processing workflow that is very easy to debug and to monitor. But in reality, you know, your workflow is going to be connected to so many other workflows. And it will be really hard to debug, you know, whenever something happens. And also, it will be really hard to detect the cost, for example, for each of the jobs. So like, if you want to know which of the jobs need cost optimization because it drains some resources and these kind of things, it will be a bit hard using the custom tools or the normal out-of-the-box solutions for cloud providers. So yeah, we built our workflow monitoring dashboard, and here are some plots or some visualizations of that. What you can see on top left here is that over time, we show the number of jobs that we're running and whether they were failed or aborted or succeeded. And what you can do, you can see on the bottom is that, you know, there is a categorization per, you know, job type. Fun thing to see here is that on the right, we have like the accumulated number of jobs throughout our work in this project. We almost reached now 12,000 jobs. And the good thing or fun thing to notice here is that in the beginning, we had a very rapid, you know, increase in the number of jobs as we were doing the testing. But then after we started, you know, the like adopting MLOps best practices, it was more efficient to test our code and the new features. And we had like a stable increase since then. So yeah, now hand it over to Edgar to talk about the current status and the future prospects.
Thank you, Mohamed. So if we move on, just to close the presentation, what we are looking or what we are trying to do now. So we are trying to still explore multiple input-output models. Concretely, we are exploring something called temporal fusion transformer that is following this trend by the famous paper, Attention is All You Need. So focusing on transformers applied to time series. But more interestingly is how this model is trying to embed these hierarchies of models, customer, or this metadata into the model itself. So in the right, you can see some experiments that we have done with decent results, still not, let's say, concluding, but everything indicates that maybe in the future, we might be able to move to one model to rule them all and to decrease the complexity and infrastructure cost of our solutions. And then the last thing that we would like to do moving forward is to harmonize our machine learning monitoring and visualization and collection system. Because right now we have a couple of handcrafted dashboards that we have made using our workflow monitoring tables and error data marts for the different models. But we believe that maybe there is a better way to go. So we are trying to adopt the ELK stack. So to, you know, move the dashboards to Kibana and to move the log search as well as the log storage to Elasticsearch and log stash. Before closing, I would like to give you one more finite lesson that I think is the most important of all of them, and is that machine learning is a team sport. So today it was me and Mohamed, the public faces of what we did with Dispatch Optimizer and also what we are doing in industrial applications. But this would not be possible without a very good team of software engineers, software architects, data engineers, MLOps engineers or software engineers that they wear the hat of MLOps, plus, of course, our product owners, product managers, and our sales commercialization team that is trying to help us to onboard the successful pilots for Dispatch Optimizer. If you have liked the presentation, you can stay later for the roundtable for question and answers. We are located in Finspång, a village close to Norrköping. Just 150, 200 kilometers from Stockholm. We are currently hiring, and thank you for today.